We will discover that it's a text that the main subject might appear to be money giving, but I wanted you to see today that that's really not the main subject in the text of money, because if I start talking about money, some of y'all gonna turn me off mighty fast. But when we look at this text, we can draw the conclusion of money being the main subject, because we see in the text that the Bible said that there were people that were casting in money into the treasury. The treasury then consisted of 13 trumpets, or it was 13 drums that were strategically placed around the temple. They didn't take up money like we took up money. We take up money. We pass a basket, and the brethren walk down through the aisles, and some of you put some in, and some of you just look at it when it go by. But what they would do is they were 13 trumpets, 13 drums, and they were strategically placed around the temple, and each of these drums were marked. In other words, it had different reasons, different things that they were giving, and what the money was giving, and where the money would be used as it related to the temple. And I want you to see here that as they were walking in, they were the rich people, the Bible says. They were casting in their monies into these different trumpets. And I need you to see that these trumpets were made out of metal. And so they were giving coins and putting different coins into these different trumpets. And they were doing it so that everybody could see it. And I want to say this to you as well, that's why giving is not a private matter. Now, some of y'all say giving is private, but giving is not private. Giving is really public. And the reason that it is a public matter, if I put 13 receptacles around this building, or if on Sunday morning the brethren didn't walk down through the aisle and pass the plate, it would mean that you would have to walk down here and find the different spots, and then you would be able to drop your money in there, and everybody in the room would be able to see you when you do it. Now, the reason I'm saying to you that giving is a public matter, because when you walk down to give, you are letting everybody in here know that God's been good to me, that God has somehow blessed me. And that's why, brothers, you should come up in a bread at Osiris and tithe prayer, praying for the folk who ain't got nothing to give, because that ain't never the truth. This text even kills that idea that you don't ever have anything to give. And so I want you to see that when they were coming down in there to give, and they were casting in their coins, and everybody could see the coins. And not only could they see the coins, but they could also hear the coins. Some of you know about coins because that's what you put in the church. Even though we use paper money now, many of you every now and again gather up your coins and you try to silently put them in that little basket, amen, so as it will not make no noise. But I want you to know that when these folks were casting into the treasury, they were noisy givers. Yeah, they were casting in there. And when they were casting in there, it would make all kind of noise. And here is the issue, that some of them felt like that the more noise they made, that means they were the best givers, because the more coins that dropped up in there, then the more noise that it indicated that they were giving. In verse number 41 of your text, verse 41, the Bible says that they cast in much. But what I want you to see is that when they cast in much, and while they were casting in, I need you to see that it may have been impressive to all of those that were observing it. But now here is the issue. They're casting their money in there, and you can see when the big spenders come in there, Brother Jack, you know what I'm saying about a big spender. Yeah, all right, I just had to identify one in the church. And then they walk in there and cast it in there and make all that noise, and folk would say about them, well, yeah, he the one that showed up got it. And they liked that because it looked like it was impressive. And it may have been impressive to other folk, but I want you to see that there was one among them that was observing, and he was not impressed. Brother Smith. And verse number 43, the Bible says that Jesus witnessed these folk as they were casting in their money. He then called to his wife. He calls to his disciples at verse number 43. And he said, "Verily I say unto you, that this poor widow, she's done what? She's cast in more in than all of they which have cast into the treasury. But why? Because she has cast in, for they have cast in of their abundance, but she of her want did cast in all that she had, even all of her what? All of her living." And I want you to notice that when you look at this text, that all Jesus is simply trying to do is denote a difference between the big spenders. And he wanted you to want us to be able to see that I'm not impressed by folk who come into the church and when they give and it makes a lot of noise. Now maybe I'm gonna get off the coins here, because maybe some of y'all come in here and you fold up a good check, you fold up a few 20s and you put that in the plate. All I want you to see here is that Jesus saying that that kind of giving does not impress me. Don't you sit there and somehow believe that when you write a check, that somehow it means that you have somehow impressed God, because God is not impressed no matter how big your check may be. At verse number 49, I need you to see that Jesus is not impressed. At verse number 44, brother, Jesus is not impressed, because the Bible said that when they cast,
impressed by pretense. Now, what do you mean by pretense? He's not impressed just by
verse 38. Mark 12 and verse 38. The book says what? Mark 12, 38 says what?
In his doctrine.
He said unto them, read.
Beware of the scribes.
He says, beware of the scribes.
Which love to go in long clothing.
He says, because watch them. When they come, when the scribes come in, they come in wearing long clothing. Read.
And love salutation.
And I need to tell you in here this morning that just because you come to church dressed up and you dress from head to toe, amen. Amen. You won't impress the Lord.
Amen.
And y'all can sit there and act like that if you want to. There are people like that. Just wait in another 2 more weeks for they have Easter Sunday. The folk gonna be dressed up in the Easter bench. I preach a sermon dressed up but messed up, amen. Cause one can come to church and you be all dressed up and walk in, and some folk come late, amen, just so they can be seen, amen. Come to church as if you're coming for a fashion show. Now while that person got the Bible, come as you are, you know that ain't in the Bible. Because you know we gotta teach folk how to come, amen. Because if we let everybody come as they are, they gonna distract the pulpit, amen. I know it ain't gonna bother you nothing, but it might. It just might, amen. That's why it's good to have glaucoma, amen. But I'm here to tell you today that that verse ain't in the Bible. But sometimes people think that because they put on their Sunday best and they come to church and they find their favorite chair, the Lord. In fact, the Lord is so unimpressed.
which devour widows' houses.
He said, here's the reason why I'm not impressed, because you look at these fellas, but look at you, you don't understand how they got rich. They got rich because they devour, that simply means they were ripping off widows. Y'all follow me? And I want to tell you something right here in Lafayette. You just like that, right here in the Lafayette in Louisiana. I almost said Lafayette, but right here in the Lafayette in Louisiana, there are preachers like that who will take advantage of widows. In other words, they are hoping, amen, that the old man die. So they can get 20% of their check, 12% of their check. I'm looking at some of you brothers out here now, got a nice price on your head too. See, when you love God, you're going to love some other folks. Put a reading book says what?
Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself.
Say, you gotta love your neighbor as thyself. Read.
There is none other commandment greater than
thee. He said, ain't no other. You know why he said, ain't no other great commandment? Because once you master that commandment, everything else becomes a whole lot easier after that. You ain't got to worry about thou shalt not steal and thou shalt not kill.
Is not
just about your money. You follow? Money is not the issue here. The issue here is that Jesus is trying to teach disciples to see past an outward performance and not be impressed by a pretense and be impressed by somebody's appearance of what they do. Because appearances can get you in a whole lot of trouble. I would digress a moment and tell you that if you're not married here, you're single here, especially in this world, you had better look beyond the mascara. Amen. Amen. You had better look past the muscle. Amen. Amen. And start looking all the way down into the heart. That's exactly what the Bible said, I think, in 1 Samuel 16 and verse number 7, when David was marched out there and he said he would go and fight against the Philistine. And the Lord had said that David is the man that he had chosen to be the king. And the brothers looked at David and said, he's ruddy. He's just ruddy in his appearance. And then the Lord came back and said, the Lord don't look on the outward, what? The appearance. To drive the point, Jesus places the spotlight on the unlikely person. Verse number 42, he places the spotlight on a poor widow. Now, I want y'all to see this. Notice he saw all the other stuff as he was standing there. He saw the men putting their money up in there. And, you know, he looked at that. And maybe other folks applauding them for what they did. But then the Bible said that Jesus, verse number 43, he called his what?
Disciples.
You see it? And when he called them, he didn't call them because he was impressed by those men, but he called them because he was impressed by this poor widow who had cast in two mites. And let me tell y'all what two mites were. Two mites were, wasn't even a penny. Two mites was like a half a penny. I mean, you could cut a penny in half, then you got what she had. I mean, and you know, I tell you this too as I digress again. One thing I've learned in my old age, I don't even walk with pennies. When I was a young fellow, I see a penny, I walk with a penny like it wasn't no money. But I bet you money, I was down here at the Chick-fil-A the other day, and my order came out to 701. That girl stood there until I found my penny. Because, you know, folk understand even a penny is impressive. So here is a woman who had, she didn't even have a penny. She had a half of a penny. But now, Jesus is taking notice of her. That they had. And I want you to see here at verse number 43, he called the disciples, and you can almost imagine Jesus said, come see. Come here, Peter. Come here, John. Come here, Bartholomew. Come here. I want to show y'all something. Come and see something that I find that is really impressive. Come see this poor widow, and come see, because she has done something that really impresses me. She has cast. Thank you. mad that lady walking in and saying, here go my last cellular phone. What makes a person do that? That person has to have some faith in God. That if I put in my last, God who gave me that will give me something more. What would make me give like that? Because I believe that I love God so much that the God I serve is able to give me something more if I love him first. That's why I'm saying you the first commandment to love God with all your heart. That's why you should never come to service.
Splendor and magnificence. He says that verse
verse number 1 of chapter 13, read.
As he went out of the temple.
Now check it out now, church. He was in the temple, and now he did what?
Went out.
Now he's leaving the temple. Go to read.
One of his disciples said unto him.
Now keep in mind, he just sat there and taught this fellow. He said, look at that woman. Look at that poor widow. You know, that's what's saying. Sometimes what impresses Jesus don't even impress us.
Amen.
Go to read.
Master, see what manner of stones.
And let me tell y'all something. Just because you try to flatter the law with Master, he already told you he wasn't impressed. In fact, he said in Luke 6:46, why you call me Lord and Master? But you don't even do the stuff I tell you. Jesus said, in other words, you might come to somebody and say, hey, what's up, big dog? And they get impressed. That's why I ain't impressed. My mom didn't name me big dog. Matter of fact, Brother Bill started calling me sometime. He called me. He said, what's up, big time? I said, you got the wrong number. Got the wrong number? Wrong number. But I'm telling you, you can't be flattered by all that because Jesus said, you called me Master, but that don't flatter me. Read.
See what manner of stones and what manner and what buildings are here.
Now you notice what the disciples said. He said, Master, let's go around here. See all these nice stones and buildings. Because you know why? They're impressed by what they see. Go to read.
And Jesus answering said unto him.
Now watch the Master. Jesus said, okay, yeah, go to.
Seest thou these great buildings?
He said, yeah, I see them.
There shall not be one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down.
You see that? He said, yeah, I see them, but I'm not. I'm not impressed. Glory.
And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, over against the temple, Peter and James and John and Andrew asked him privately.
Now the man went from standing outside in the temple to standing outside it, just chilling next to him. And they said, it'll come out of him. And that's the same way some of y'all are in church. And sit up there a whole hour letting me preach. You know how long I preach, but you don't even get the message.
Amen.
You come right in here, hear it, get right outside, and forget it. Still impressed by what Jesus is not impressed by. Go to read.
Tell us which shall these things be, and what shall be.
That's good enough, and I don't want to go through all the signs. I just want y'all to see how it is that we sometimes can behave the exact same way. Impressed by buildings, impressed by this, impressed by that. And you know why Jesus not impressed by none of that? Because he will go on to tell them that there's coming a time the temple in Jerusalem was destroyed in 70 AD. Then he goes on to tell them not only was the temple in Jerusalem be destroyed, but one day this world and everything in it. I want to say in conclusion, don't get so impressed by all the stuff you see. The stuff that impresses me is the fact that God can make the sun come up and make the sun go down, the stars come out, and all that kind of, the stuff that's really impressive is the stuff that God can do. There is nothing that a man can do that you can't do. You follow that? So you ought not be so amazed and so impressed by all of that, but the stuff that God can do that can't nobody else do ought to be the stuff that you showed up fine, impressive. Well, the lesson is yours today. And I draw your mind to this. If your mind is here and not somewhere lost, somewhere else.
Yes, sir.
Church, let me tell you something. Jesus said, where there are two or three gathered in my name, there I am in the midst. How can I know it? I must have some faith. In a moment, you're going to get ready to take communion. Jesus is somewhere positioned by faith. He will observe you. Not that you pick up the little cracker, because that's all, something that's all they see as. Not that you took the little cup, but he's going to be looking all the way into your heart. And you might impress somebody by you taking the cup. But remember, the one who's really observing is the one who can look all the way in your heart. That's why the Bible says, let a man examine himself. If you take this stuff sitting there mad and upset and out of fellowship, drink damnation. In fact, Jesus said to those men, they already are damned and receive the greater damnation. See, some of you up here worried about going to hell. Worried about going to hell. You're already in hell right now. Mentally, you're there because you have not locked in on your relationship. Only thing you do is wait for the transport now. You just waiting on the transport now. And then, secondly, we're going to pass a collection plate in a moment. Jesus is somewhere positioned. You can ball up them $3 as tight as you want to ball them up. Because that was some of y'all taking this as a dollar. And that's what many of us think of the Lord right here. This is what you think about him. And you'll take that thing and you'll squeeze it all up and drop it. And then we got to take a hammer. And you don't want your neighbor next to you to see. Some of y'all done got your income tax return and been shopping. But didn't even think about the Lord. And he's somewhere every Sunday just watching you write that check. That's why I'm telling y'all, give it as a matter of the heart. Because you'd be sitting there writing the same thing for the last 10 years and think you're doing something impressive. You've been putting the same amount there for 10 years. You mean tell me God ain't done nothing more for you in 10 years? A nickel more? At least I'll go to 3105. When it's time to pray, some of y'all don't even pray. You don't even bow your head. You be looking around the room. You be dip that door open. Jesus is standing right over there against the treasure, just sitting there checking, saying, look at her. Some brothers in there praying and she ain't even bowing her head. He ain't said a prayer. When it comes time to sing, he just sitting right over there just checking it out. You ain't even got the songbook open. Man, you ain't even lip syncing. You just sitting here, but yet you come every Sunday. That don't impress me. And it surely don't impress the Lord. Because when you come in here, he's going to be judging your heart. The sermon, that's the other act of worship, right? See, that's the whole sermon. Some of y'all doing this, checking your watch out, your clock out, hoping that I hear when I finish. But let scandal come on. Oh, what's that new one? Empire. Some of y'all can't make the Bible play. Come on at 8 o'clock. You won't even come and leave here early. But let it come a sermon. Man, you ain't even swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to rap. You don't even receive it with me. And Jesus standing right over there just checking it out and saying, no wonder she can't handle this. No wonder he can't handle life. Because they come in here, sit in their chair to be seen before, but they don't never leave here again and nothing in anything real. So I'm asking you today, what should I do when I come to a point of just doing everything out of pretense and performance? Y'all know how we are. Any husband or wife in here, let your wife bring your food and say, here it is. Somehow or another, something you're going to tell you, I don't want that plate today. Because the heart ain't right. Right? Well, God will reject your worship. He'll reject your money when your heart is not right. And I beg you today, you can get more out of worship when you really lock in with one here. There is an object for worship, which is God. There is an objective for worship, which is to worship God. And there is an obligation to worship, which is to come in here and do those things that God asks of me to do. Not for pretense, not for performance, but because I love the Lord with all of my heart, with all of my mind, and all of my soul. Is there any here today that you need to get that right? I beg you, by faith, by repentance. What is repentance? Repentance means I've heard something, I realize, hey man, I've just been faking in front, but I found out today ain't no future. then I need to do what? Get that right. Because while I may fool some folks some of the time, there Jesus is. Right over there. Right over there. And you know what? There is the Father looking down from heaven. And he don't care you coming. He can ask you this, why you even come? Because you coming for people. Coming for the wrong reason. Here because of God and because of Jesus. If you hear today, you're not saved. Today is a great day. The water is ready and clear water too. Right. Now I can't say if it's warm, but I know it's sure to clear. You can see the bottom of the pool. And brother can shock the pool so many times, I tell you, he got super shock in there. That'll shock your seat. Just wait. That'll shock your seat. And some of you say, but I wanna get it right with the Lord. Well, let me tell you how you get it right. Soul stain, man. I'd rather save my soul and give God a chance to do something with me. Brother Taylor, hold your hand up, Brother Taylor. Hold your hand up, Brother Taylor. Brother Taylor, y'all hold your hand up now. Come on, brother. You. Brother Taylor, you don't want to put on the spot. This man obeyed the gospel tonight. Amen. All the angels in heaven rejoice over one sinner. Ain't that glad that you can't hear them, but they were rejoicing. See, he didn't want me put on the spot like that, but I'm sorry, brother. I've been preaching too long. When the Lord can call the chief sinner, I got to say something about it. Amen, somebody. And the fact is that means there's hope for anybody who obey the Lord. Amen. Y'all are saying this church, the angels rejoice. You know what that means, my brother. You know what that means, man. You know what that means. When they say, I'm only coming to you because see, you only but a year old in the faith. But that's some joy, somehow I believe you have. Don't never let them take your joy. Been in this name too long. Let's be standing. Caleb, what we say?
Yield not to temptation.
Well,
83 of your voters.
Well, Caleb, let's say yield not to temptation. And any of y'all folk that think you can press the Lord, then you just need to know you're fooling yourself because you can't do it. As we say,
yield